not very nice. We Jews believe it was Santa Claus that killed Jesus Christ. You know, you don't look Jewish, he said, near as I could figure. I had you lamped for a slightly anemic, well-dressed country nigger. All they making Jews like Jesus sent them all. They don't turn the other cheek the way they done before. He started into shouting and spitting on the floor. Lord, they ain't making Jews like Jesus sent them all. Keep it country, boy. He says, I ain't a racist, but Aristotle Onassis is one Greek we don't need. And them niggers, Jews, and Sigma Nus, all they ever do is breathe. And wops and mix and slopes and spicks and spooks are on my list. And there's one little heeb from the heart of Texas. Is there anyone I miss? Well, I hits him with everything I had right square between the eyes. I says, I'm gonna get to you, son of a bitch. You're spouting that pack of lies. If there's one thing I can't abide, it's an ethnocentric racist. Now you take back that said about Aristotle Onassis. All they ain't making Jews like Jesus sent them on. We don't turn the other cheek the way we done before. You could hear that honky holler as he hit that hardwood floor. Lord, I ain't making Jews like Jesus anymore. Everybody in America now. I ain't making Jews like Jesus anymore. They ain't making carpenters who know what nails are for. Well, the whole damn place was singing as I stole right out the door. Lord, rain making Jews like Jesus anymore.
I want to grow up to be just like Jesus and never have to work. Just travel around from town to town, wherever evil lurks. Cross the whole
treatment.
I want, why?
This whole new lifestyle, this isn't working out.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not. You have been absolutely out of your mind today.
How?
And why? Why are you screaming at these people?
Because...
Poor little Lou. I mean, the slightest thing goes one hair amiss and you go ballistic. What is the matter with you?
Why are you...
What is wrong with you? What in God's name is wrong with you?
Plenty.
What in God's name is wrong with you? What's the matter with you? Tell me what is wrong with you. I'm serious. What in God's name is wrong with you?
Nothing.
Everything is wrong with you. Why do you do this? Why do you treat these people like that until we have one of these horrible episodes on the air?
Because
why?
Let me answer.
Tell me what is wrong. Tell me what drives you to that point. Tell me. Explain it to me. It makes no sense. What? You can't answer me, can you? No, you can't, because there is no answer.
Closer to the mic.
There's no answer for this. God.
Why are you screaming at me?
Because you finally drive me to this, and you do it about once a month anymore, and it's got to stop.
No.
You've got to get yourself under control.
I'm fine.
You need shock therapy. You're not fine.
I don't need anything. I simply say, Bernard gives me this dumb kid on the air who's supposed to talk...
And I'm sure the kid didn't sound dumb. He sounded fine. You take a shot. But you don't malign Bernard then.
And
for crying out loud.
Then I'm talking to the kid, and where's Lou? wandering around the back of the studio.
Looking for a nifty promo! So that you...
We can't have the nifty promo.
Oh, man.
If I'm talking to the kid and I want to get out of it.
Fine, I wish you'd get out of it, me and the studio. The studio. No. I tell you, I can't. I don't know. I really don't. I just don't know.
Well, I just...
I'm sorry I yelled at you.
What good does it do you to go to this Bible study? You actually preached at your church last Sunday.
Yes, I did.
And then to scream at me for 5 minutes.
We all fail. We all fall short.
Well, boy, you just fell short.
Turn
it around on me now.
No, but he's here having to wipe his mouth with his handkerchief because he's drooling on himself. Aren't you?
Yes, I was.
Fat loser.
In the headlines. Who's a fat loser?
Stop, Bernie.
You're a loser. Now he's fat?
No, he's a fathead.
Well, what's he done now?
Took the day off.
Oh, come on. He didn't take the day off. He's there. He's right there. Look at him. There he is.
One of those days.
Okay. Fine. Why did he get $300 deducted from his Christmas bonus?
Well, various little glitches.
Yeah.
That's all. So is he down three?
Imaginary.
He's down $300. Imaginary? $400.
Oh, he just went...
Oh, my God. Lose up four?
I got a lot of credit now.
He's down four, lose up four.
All right.
But I'm telling you, by the time we go on vacation for Christmas, you're going to owe me money.
I wish you were down six.
Hello, this is Rush Limbaugh, imploring you to pause for just a moment and listen to a tragic story that I guarantee will move you. This is Bill. Now, Bill's not going to bed hungry every night. I mean, obviously, one look at this picture and you can plainly see that he's not exactly missing any meals. He doesn't need clothing. He's actually a pretty natty dresser. He's not homeless. He and his lovely wife and adorable teenage daughter reside in a very nice house in a fine neighborhood with more than competent live-in help. And unlike those pictures of those refugee kids that Sally Struthers shows you, there are no flies buzzing around Bill's head. Although that metal one down there in his trousers has caused him quite a bit of trouble lately. He may not look it, but folks, Bill needs your help. He and his wife work very hard every day to create the kind of government that they think will serve the American people best. But they only pull down $293,000 a year to do it, and right now that's just not going to get it done. See, Bill's accumulated quite a few bills. Legal bills.
Well,
bills that add up to a lot of money. The wolves are at the door, and Bill's wearing Alpo boxer shorts. Now, he'd gladly take on a second job if he could, but the one he's got is pretty darn consuming. Why, he barely has the time to have wanton illicit sex with chesty, morally bankrupt hussies, let alone deal with Haiti, Korea, and all those other countries he can't even spell. He's so busy trying to establish a national health care plan, for us, mind you, not himself, his is taken care of. He's so busy trying to push through his socialist ideology for the good of our country, when what he should be doing is attempting to institute a national legal care plan that he could use. And that's where you come in.
Yeah.
Please, if you could just send $1,000.
Pardon me?
That's less than $3 a day. Not a lot, but it would mean so much to Bill and his family, and it certainly would go a long way to provide the legal care they so desperately need. $3 buys a dozen file folders, or two notice of motion forms and a box of pencils, or can be applied towards the purchase of expert defense and alibi witnesses. In other words, the basic necessities that Bill will need to get himself and his family out of the horribly litigious state they are forced to live in. He feels your pain. Let him know that you feel his.
Oh, okay.
Send your tax-deductible donation to Save the Clinton, P.O. Box 1996, Washington, D.C. And don't forget to watch me, Barbara Streisand, Sharon Stone, Fleetwood Mac, and Nipsey Russell on the Save the Clinton Telethon, or as we're calling it, Zipperade. Every right-wing boy and girl all around the industrialized world gonna do the Limbaugh rock. All around the Limbaugh clock. Bubba be nimble, Willie be slick. First husband Clinton makes me sick. Be the first one on your block. Try and do the Limbaugh rock. Limbaugh's to the right now. A little further to the right now. A little further to the right. How conservative can you go? Clinton's main artillery is that shrew Miss Hillary. We here at the EIB fear her feminazi tyranny. Though she loves to politic, she'd be better at turning tricks. Don't intend to offend or shock. I'm just doing the Limbaugh rock. And now, time for another homosexual update. According to Outweek, the, you should excuse the expression, homosexual rag, gay weddings are on the rise. My question is, at a homosexual wedding, where do they stick the bouquet? White's my face and red's my neck. Quite far from politically correct. Lifetime member of the NRA. Same goes for the KKK. All the homeboys in my hood all wear hoods like homies should. Put a Negro in a hammerlock. Come on, do the Limbaugh rock. Come on over to the right now. You don't have to be that bright now. How conservative can you go? Rush Limbaugh saying Sieg Heil. And remember, folks, if an Afro-American, liberal, lesbian, feminazi Jew should move into your neighborhood, do the right thing. Kill her. More after this.
Ray Phillips is here. How are you, bro?
Pretty good.
Ray's a fireman with Rescue 3, right?
Up at the Bronx, yeah.
This is a legitimate deal. I have Maliq Sealy's Playoffs 1993 Pacers versus Knicks playbook. Game notes.
This is... figure right now he's telling the coach that Bill gave his homework.
You know, they have all the stats here. Four-game statistical breakdown. Here are player profiles. Greg Anthony, backup point guard, very quick, good ball handler, passer, looks to drive all the time. Have to play show and go defense on him. We can get him rattled, mistake prone. Shooting is erratic, but has shot it well against us. Plays good defense, good on the ball defender, strong for his size, hard nosed. So on. Here's,
Oh man,
how great is his brother? Tony Campbell, shooter, scorer, needs the ball to be effective, mostly catch and shoot player. Will drive left, has turnaround jump shot in post, will go to offensive board, very poor defense. Must go right at him if he plays. Terrible ball handler, turnover prone. If he plays, it's for his offense. This from the, how great is this from the Pacers versus Knicks playoff book.
You never know what you can find in an airport these days.
Oh, man, how great is this? Here's what they say about Patrick Ewing. Having MVP year, team looks for him to carry them. Has great post-up game. Favorite move is to post up and take you off the dribble to the middle or shot off one leg. Good shooter to 18 feet. Goes to offensive boards. Will also take the fall-away jumper on baseline.
Yeah.
Susceptible to foul trouble. Goes for fakes.
Oh.
If he goes out, they struggle. Runs the floor extremely well. Must run back with him. We must take away his move to the middle and live with his fall-away jumper. His mission is to win it all. This is, how great is this?
This is fantastic.
Man. Oh, man. Hey. Doc Rivers, strong, love to hit people. Solid defender off the ball. Very good offensive rebounder. Hey, Breen, did you meet Ray?
I did.
Did you see this? You'd understand this even better than us. Here is the offensive overview for the Pacers versus the Knicks. From Maliq Sealy's playbook, we'll look for opportunity breaks, but generally like to run a controlled attack with set plays. Expect post-up for Patrick on either block. We'll also post Smith and Mason in early defense and off-cross screens. Like to attack the right side in early offense and reverse to look to a jump shot, but post-up on opposite side. They have all their offensive sets here. So if they're screaming, what would they say? Did they scream like through or?
Sure.
Okay, through. This would be one dribble, two, through, and looks to feed Ewing. If pass is not available, reverse to four. If it's two, come on. I don't understand. Right, but yeah. Who should we give this to?
I think we should continue to read. This is unprecedented. It's unbelievable.
I mean, this is ridiculous. Defensive overview? Oh, man.
I love the player profiles.
They might not let him play tonight. He doesn't know his plays.
Well, they have all the plays here and stuff. But But essentially, well, you Breen, you look through this and see what.
Page one, put your sneakers on. High laces, page two.
Expect baseline screening. Here's something else. Does this make any sense, Breen? Expect baseline screening plays for Blackman and Starks, like to run single double for Rowe. We'll cross two and three like normal baseline action, also double curl both off Patrick's side.
That's where Starks and Blackman get all their points. They go down underneath the basket, the guy sets a pick for them, and they come around. That's exactly it.
Oh, you should notice, Don, you've been doing enough games.
Well, I don't know anything about it, you know.
Page five.
So Ray won't take the money. He wants me to donate the money to the Tomorrow's Children's Fund, so
we appreciate
it, so I'll donate. In fact, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll donate $1,000.
All right.
And your guy's name to the Tomorrow's Children's Fund. And then we'll give you two tickets for the game tonight. In fact, you got the two tickets we have.
Thank you.
But now it'll work that out for you. Well, so thank you very much. Who actually found this?
One of the guys in the company, a guy named Mike Morrissey.
Right.
He's out of JFK Airport, and there was a little mistake in the flights, and he went to a phone booth to make a phone call to find out what flight he was supposed to be picking these people up, and he looked down, and he found this book in the phone booth.
Yeah. Make sure you thank Maliq when you go to the game tonight.
It was a teenage wedding, and the old folks wished him well. You could see truly love the mademoiselle. And now the young monsieur and madame have rung the chapel bell. C'est la vie, c'est the old folks. It goes to show you never can tell.
I miss in the morning.
Okay.
And thank you from the bottom of my heart. Daniel Ellsberg in the morning. You know, not since the infamous Pentagon Papers has there been such a flap over a document falling into the wrong hands as the one that developed when you got your f***ing flippers there on poor Maliq Sealy's Indiana Pacers playbook.
Well,
you know, Maliq would have been better off had he simply taken the playbook and handed it to Pat Riley. Here, Coach, I feel guilty playing for Indiana and being from New York. Take this. All it is the entire accumulated knowledge of everything our coach and all of his assistants ever acquired regarding the game of basketball and how we play it. Murphy's Law, Maliq. Murphy's Law. If the worst possible thing can happen, it will. And at the worst possible time, with the worst possible ogre in control. Jesus. Anyway, we move ahead into the day's other issues.
Okay.
Issue one, speaking of information leaks, Bubba Clinton. You know, I, too, am hearing from unimpeachable sources that Bubba is again seeking to emulate Jack Kennedy, who had a little Bay of Pigs incident in Cuba.
Right.
And now Billy Boy has one in Hollywood. Kennedy invaded beaches. Bubba invaded, well, starts with B and rhymes with snitches. Happened during that summit with Boris Yeltsin.
Yeah.
So here's the main question. What is the over-under on how soon this buffoon shows up with another goose egg in his noggin from Hillary slamming a broom over his head, huh?
Yeah, the one she was riding.
Good one, Dono. Issue two. Has Bubber come down with his decision Bosnia yet? I didn't see the papers over the weekend, but anyway, has this option been explored? Play real loud music at them, then set their country on fire, and then blame Janet Reno. Is that perfect or what? Quick, get me Les Aspin. Oh, by the way, how's he doing anyway?
Fine.
Did he get one of those oven timer tickers stuck in his chest?
Yes.
Now, in my view, in light of recent medical advances, that was a completely unnecessary procedure.
Right.
All Les Aspin needed, had he known, was a little shot of what I now swear by. Vital K. And does Dick Nixon ever want to thank the I-Man for turning him on to this chance? I mean, look at this. One little swig and... Whoa! Stand back. I don't know how big this thing gets. Forget Les Aspin. Bring me the head of Cindy Crawford. Yikes! Okay, let's settle down here. Issue three. Those first 100 days.
All right.
Quick thought, since I was unable to address the matter last week.
Okay.
Let's assess. Bubber promised that middle-class tax cut. Look at this. 100-odd days later, he has proposed what Senator Pat Moynihan says will be, and I quote, the largest tax increase in the history of public finance.
Oh,
great. Huh. Well, what do you know?
Yeah.
Okay, he vowed to move heaven and earth to control spending. 100 days go by, and he's proposing, well, what do you know? $196 billion in new spending. Huh. All right, then. Surely he's getting this deficit under control, right?
Yeah.
Because he damn sure said he'd balance the budget. 100 days in, and he plans a program that'll increase the national debt by almost $1.5 trillion over 5 years. Well, too bad somebody didn't leave the Clinton playbook lying around a phone booth back before last November.
Yeah.
Because if the public had been able to get an advance look at those first 100, Bill Clinton would not be in the White House today. I don't know about you, but it kind of makes me hanker for some jelly beans. Oh. Hey, Dono, huh?
You're on the phone with us now from the Indiana Pacers, Maliq Sealy. Good morning, Maliq.
How you doing?
Fine, baby. How are you?
Not so good.
Yeah? I'll be up to that. So this fireman calls me, and he says he found your playbook, which I have here in front of me.
Right.
Out at the airport.
And I see you thoroughly enjoying it.
Well,
you know it.
Sam. Did you know you were missing it?
Well, I did realize that I was missing it, but I didn't realize it would end up in the hand of such tasteless gentlemen. I mean, if you feel that a need to make tasteless jokes about it, then that's fine. And, you know, if that's the level of, I don't even know how to describe.
Yeah. You're right, it is a level.
That is
First of all, you're right, it is a level. Okay,
and I just want to say that after all of interviews I've done to FAN, I'm really sorry that I even took time to help you guys out in any way if you would turn around and stab me in the back like this.
Well, let me explain something. Oh, go ahead.
If you feel it appropriate to make a need to make fun of this particular situation, then, you know, I just want to say that I find it very tasteless and I don't find it funny at all.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and I don't even know what else to say to you guys, you know, because
anytime
you ask me to do something, I try to be very helpful.
Well, here's the thing. We're not really part of the radio station. This is the Imus in the Morning program. They do sports the rest of the day, so.
It's a
separate entity. Mm-hmm. So if we'd have known you'd have been that cooperative with the station, we probably wouldn't have done this, you know. But these are the playoffs, Maliq.
Well, I understand but I'm human, just like you guys are human.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
I understand.
I mean, if you guys make a mistake, would you like to be publicized nationwide or?
No, I wouldn't. But what would you expect me to do if I found it?
I wouldn't expect you to talk about it on the radio like you are.
Oh, come on, man. What's the matter with you?
Nothing's the matter with me. Is something the matter with you?
There's nothing the matter with me. We're Knicks fans, and you guys are Pacers, and it's just basketball. It's
just
not
fun here.
You know, it's not cancer. It's not real life.
Sure.
It's, you lost your playbook. Next time, keep it in your bag.
Okay.
Right,
I'm glad you guys found it to be really funny.
Yeah,
I'm glad I got through and got to know that this is really tasteless, and I guess that tells that you guys are tasteless.
I'll grow up and get over this, man.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moments of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guessed my name.
I'm a in the morning.
Well, you already heard about how good from the Archdiocese, his eminence. John Cardinal O'Connor.
Stupid earring in your... Get it out there, yo.
With the New York Lotto numbers. Good morning, Cardinal O'Connor.
Good morning to God, lass. Been a long time, I missed the mark.
Yes, it has.
Not long enough, you cradle-robbing cadaver, you be Jesus.
That will be fine.
The winning numbers of the New York State Lottery is as follows.
That's why you're here, to report those, and that's it.
So how are things going for the I-Man here on Meet the Putts?
Where are the numbers?
Taking a little heat from the bagel-eating media for being the low-rent social retard that you are, I'm
sure. Well, yes, a little.
Enough of the bull shenanigans. I'll tell you what's really offensive.
What?
Really offensive is listening to the likes of Nina Totenberg.
Well?
The beast of the Beltway.
Leave her alone.
Yak on about this or that. Ad nauseam, be Jesus. What's vulgar is the sound of your cocaine-damaged nostrils wheezing in the background, I tell you that. Obscene is your salary, you pigeon-chested pedophile, you.
Pigeon-chested pedophile?
Daily number.
Well, what are they?
109.
All right, 109.
Speaking of bad taste, I missed the mark.
Yes.
I think it was NBC. Had the big movie of the week Sunday night.
Mm-hmm.
About a woman with breast cancer, be Jesus.
Well, now, I hope we're not going to take this where I think we're going to take it.
They actually call it My Breast.
Yes.
I guess we're lucky she didn't have rectum cancer, be Jesus.
You know, that's not necessary.
My arse on TV, I tell you.
Cardinal O'Connor?
Can't wait for the movie about prostate cancer.
That will be fine.
My wiener, be Jesus. Make you sick.
Didn't I ask you about this?
Let me ask you this, I missed the mark.
What?
What do you get when you cross a crooked politician with a crooked lawyer?
I don't know.
Chelsea Clinton, P.G., I tell you that. The wind phone number.
Oh, wind phone number. Oh, that's a great one.
0928.
Well, what was that again? That was good.
American idiot. Dumb bastard.
That will be fine. We don't need to resort to vulgarity here.
All right, boys and girls. Carl will come up with a little springtime limerick for you out there.
Oh, good. I like the springtime limericks.
Gather around the radio, boys and girls.
All right, we're all gathered around.
We'll call it Hope and Despair.
Hope and Despair.
Ah, yes, Clinton's in trouble.
Well, you have, Cardinal, we've talked about this for 5 years. We have to talk a little louder.
A little disappointed, I, Mr. Mark.
What?
I thought by now you'd be dead, be Jesus.
Well, let's just do our little limerick.
Ah, yes, Clinton's in trouble as we approach the summer. But the I-man's alive, and that's a bummer. Paula Sue's bill says she knows what's in his shorts. But what if the evidence won't stand up in the court?
Well, fine.
The I-man to marry before much time elapses. Let's wish on his big day that the good lung collapses. Bubba's BJ from PJ in exchange for a job. Hey, what's D.D. Myers done for this slob?
That'll be fine.
So there's hope in the air. Do not despair. Al Gore in 94. No more eye jive in 95.
That was it?
It went for...
Victor... Well, that was really pretty weak at the end there, Cardinal.
Let me ask you this, I, Mr. Myers.
Yeah.
What do you get when you turn a blonde upside down, be Jesus?
I don't want to know.
No.
A brunette with bad breath. I tell you.
Have a God.
The wind phone number. The picture number is as follows.
I asked you.
7,
about...
10, 16, 17, 23, 24, 27, 34, 35, 38. 44, 47, 52, 53, 64, 65, 68, 70, 77. Boom. 79.
Fine.
The big jackpot this Wednesday night, hey, Mr. Morgan.
What is it?
Be a few million dollars, it will.
Well, how many million?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, BGs. We can't tell right now, Mr. Mine.
Okay,
which
fine.
Does them along and why?
All right, which does them along and why?
Which does them along and why?
Okay.
A, Bill Clinton.
Bill Clinton.
B, Calvin Klein.
Calvin Klein.
C, I'm Mr. Lamar. Which does them along and why?
Well, obviously, Calvin Klein, yeah.
Wrong, you two-legged bag of puss, you.
Oh, come on.
Well, all three of these horny deviants... Well, all three of these horny deviants are noted for swamply dropping their trousers in hotel rooms.
Yeah.
The answer is A, Bill Clinton doesn't belong, because unlike the other two, Bill Clinton doesn't bend over after dropping these drawers.
That will be
that.
Fine.
Okay, move along. Go on ahead now. Jesus.
John Cardinal O'Connor here on the I'm Mr. Morning program. And
you take that earring off, you little...
That's why he's not on very often. Lenny Bruce. Also, the Fontaine Glass Company, well, their windows, you can't even see through them.
Of course not. Fall in on you.
Yeah. They're whining.
Sure.
That's a good idea, folks. Send a complaining fax to K-Fox on your letterhead. Nitwits.
Dopes.
And this nut company. What's the name of this outfit? The Churchill Nut Company.
Yeah.
You ever had any of those nuts?
Churchill nuts? Not again, I'm not.
Mrs. Drummond.
Well, I had horrible stomach cramps. I just ate two of them.
Well, I understand that.
Yours. Get that fat Bennett Zero on the phone. This is a guy who is the general manager of, like, three radio stations in Washington, D.C., and you will see...
Yeah, here's a case in point.
And it's just like every nitwit you've ever worked for at any radio station in this country.
Yeah.
Every one of them ought to be named Ort Loftus, that geek who I worked for in Stockton, California.
Ort. Hey, Ort.
Who fired me because, you know, we...
Well, it was creative differences, wasn't
yeah.
it? I mean.
Yeah, we weren't... Yeah, we... We were going in a different direction than the I-Man. Hey, Bernie.
Yo.
Call us nut company. What time is it in California?
Good idea.
5:20.
Maybe they have a voicemail or something.
Yeah.
Let's call them. Leave a message.
Good plan.
408. Area code 408-637-4303. Where's Bennett?
He's not there.
What?
Go ahead, we'll punch it up. Line 7.
Churchill Nut Company. And...
Hello, Churchill Nut Company.
Yeah, your nuts suck.
Oh, God.
How childish and immature is that? Your nuts suck to this lady who says Churchill Nut Company.
And then he hangs up.
What is a... And then you hang up. What is a... Why, you couldn't think of it? Do you have Prince Albert in the can? Your nuts suck.
Hey, God.
You suck, your nuts suck.
Ring and run.
Sound like they were there, didn't it?
Yeah.
What's that all about? Call them back.
You idiot. Tell you there. I just choked on your nuts.
Maybe it was the wrong number. Some poor lady just picked up. Well, she said Churchill Nut got me.
Take that.
Scratch that. Oh, their nuts do suck. Oh, God, man. Cranking some poor little California company.
Hey, lady. You're not such.
You're fat, too.
Here's how my wife did. Recall my good morning, honey.
Good morning.
To the morning program, nationally syndicated gossip columnist Liz Smith. Good morning, Liz.
You ever get a song stuck in your head, and no matter what you do, you can't get rid of it?
I'm fine.
Well, ever since I read an advanced copy of The Secret Life of Chairman Mao, written by his former personal physician, Dr. Li Jisui, I've been humming, Please Don't Talk About Me When I'm Gone. In the new book, published by Random House, the figure considered the patriarch of modern communist China is painted as nothing more than a dirty old man.
Well,
literally. Apparently, the little iniquitous Oriental never bathed or brushed his teeth and preferred several young women in his bed at the same time.
Like you.
I guess he thought he could restore his declining yang with their yin.
Yeah. I can live with that.
Nothing like a licentious, unhygienic Asian to sell a few hundred thousand books, huh?
Well.
Meanwhile, Kermit the Frog is scheduled to address Oxford University's fabled debating society on the subject of life and the environment. As if Bill Clinton's attending the institution wasn't enough to destroy its reputation.
Well?
In the past, the debating society has enjoyed speeches from the likes of former President Ronald Reagan and Mother Teresa. And I guess one could assume that they're at a loss for inspirational speakers. I think it says something about the state of higher education when you have some of the finest minds in the world sitting in an auditorium for 20 minutes listening intently to a f***ing green sock. And if that isn't bizarre enough for you, check this out. Amy Ray, half of the Indigo Girls singing duo, will be featured on a new recording of the Andrew Lloyd Webber rock opera, Jesus Christ Superstar, performing the role of Jesus, while her other half, Emily Saliers, will play the part of Mary Magdalene. You can make up your own joke for that one if you want to, but if you ask me, that one's good enough all by itself.
Why don't you provide us with a joke, Liz?
You don't think that's funny on its own?
Well, no.
Two lesbians doing the Passion of Christ?
Okay, I get it. My sweet little wife, Deidre Coma. Good morning, honey.
Churchill Nut Company.
You're nuts.
Hello, honey.
Why are we using organic toilet paper, honey?
So you put chemicals in you.
He snorted half of Peru. How's this going to help him?
Too late now. If
I don't do it anymore, though.
Would help Wolfman a lot, I'm sure.
Have mercy.
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
I'll talk to you later.
You need to work on your yin.
Yeah, I'm going to work on your yang when I get home.
Ooh.
Imus in the morning.
Mr. Marshall, my name is Miss Walker, calling from Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
I do bookkeeping for my boss,
right.
And there is a charge on his latest statement. I just cannot figure out what it's for at all. And do you have the account number?
No, I don't. What is that?
It's 4339-0515-0000-5852.
Right. Okay, what's the expiration date on that?
Expiration date. What do they have it on here?
It'd be down in the lower right-hand corner. Or in the left-hand corner.
Lower left here.
In the middle. The top. On the side in the back somewhere. It's there.
I'm looking pretty hard.
Yeah, okay.
Let
me punch this up in the computer just a second here.
Okay.
All right, what's the designation on the on your bill for this charge? What is it? How much is the charge?
It's $6.18.
Right.
And it's like a phone number or something. And I just can't figure out what it is.
Just a minute. Let me see if I can get this. All right, that's a, well, I don't know how to say this. That is a charge for a, can pretty much describe as a phone sex line, a 970 sex line number.
It's a what? It's a sex line phone call? Is that what you're saying?
970-HUMP we have here.
When you say 970-HUMP, I don't know what you mean.
I don't either, ma'am. All I know is that's a designation we have in the bill here, 970-HUMP, that he apparently called. And
It's one of these, in other words, this number 415, do you have that?
Ma'am.
What?
Let me tell you something here. You have,
This is embarrassing.
I know it is.
How am I going to tell my boss?
Well, you're not
going to. I'm not going to tell him.
No, you're not. I'll tell you why, because, where are you now?
Washington, D.C.
Have you ever heard of Imus in the morning?
What is it called?
Imus in the morning.
No.
He's a disc jockey in New York.
Uh-huh.
That's me.
You're a disc jockey in New York?
Yeah, on WFAN here in New York. And we're on the air now, as a matter of fact. And we've been talking on the air. And see, we have an 800. Is this the 800 number, Bernie?
Yes, it is.
We have an 800 number here, and people get wrong numbers once in a while, and you got the wrong number, so.
Oh.
Your boss didn't call 970-HUMP.
You called the hump.
This is ridiculous.
Well, I'm not the one who placed the call. We just thought, well, we just thought, why not make your life miserable?
Goodbye.
Hey, well, fine. Don't get pissed off about it, lady.
Why,
gosh. Get bummed out at me.
970.
What a dope. In June, we'll be doing a radiothon for the Special Olympics because the World Games are going to be in Connecticut. When are they going to be there, Tim?
Who are you calling little, homeboy?
When are the Special Olympics?
Who are you calling little? Are you speaking
just answer the question. We don't have a lot of time here. When are the World Games going to be, the Special Olympics World Games going to be in Connecticut?
July 1st to July 9th of 1995, and Bernard is not welcome.
Here now, Tim Shriver, who has done a lot of wonderful work for
Thank you.
Political import. It goes like this. Oh, Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime. No help from my friends. So, oh, Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? That's it.
I'm a sin in the morning.
Welcome to...
I got the idiot on the phone.
You're supposed to be. You're supposed to, one, be fasting.
I am fasting.
On this most holy day of the Jewish year, and asking forgiveness for your sins, not using any appliances, and not answering the phone.
I'm not using any appliances. And
you answered the phone. You're
good,
not supposed
good
to.
Good friends, be it Jewish or Gentile,
right,
understand that they would not be so rude as to call because, God forbid, there could be an emergency. But you being the dirtbag that you are.
I don't think you're supposed to call people dirtbags. I don't think you're supposed to call me a...
I can say anything I want because it's the Day of Atonement, so I got plenty. I got all day to make up for what I'm going to say to you right now, you piece of garbage.
Yeah. God may forgive you, but I won't.
Colonel O'Connor. Good morning, Colonel O'Connor.
Good morning, God bless. Every day I miss the mark. Great day of the year for Jesus.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day to you, Mr. Marr. You're looking good, Mr. Marr.
Thank you.
Almost good enough for an open casket, you flea-bitten buffoon, you Jesus.
I don't really need that.
Quick, McCord, the eye man's boots are drying. You better get down and start licking before the eye man gets back.
I think that'll be enough.
You're sickening toad to you. Why don't you lick this, you drooling disaster, you Jesus? Will you be marching today, Mr. Marr?
Will I be marching?
Will you be marching with us today?
No. Well, no, I won't.
That's good, because nobody wants your filthy carcass anywhere near Fifth Avenue today, be Jesus.
No, that won't be fine.
If you're Amos, get out of me parlor. There's no welcome there for you. And if your name is Julio Wershack, get out of me house, you filthy louse, and shoot you in the back. If you're Amos, get out of me parlor. There's no welcome there for you. You're making a snow, you're sniveling bar. Short be dead if you're Amos. The morgue is the place for you.
Let me just point something out to you, Colonel O'Connor. Singing is not your strong suit.
The way the numbers in New York State Lottery is as follows.
We don't care what the numbers are.
The daily number.
All right.
636. Well, I missed the mark.
I've almost forgotten that's why Colonel O'Connor's here to read the lottery numbers. Primary.
Today is the day to set homeless people on fire, beat up queers, and knock over some Jewish tombstones.
No, it's not.
And a big thanks be to God to New York's Mayor Mussolini. Oh, geez, I mean Mayor Giuliani, but just God forgive me. We're not allowing the gay groups to march in the parade this year.
Right.
Once again, the only thing's getting blown on Fifth Avenue today will be the bagpipes, thank God.
Jesus.
You hear bottoms up, don't be alarmed, be Jesus. Oh, you never know with some of those musicians, be Jesus. Oh, me name is McNamara, put your penis in me hand.
Oh, no.
Tuesday, there's two homos in me van. Oh, Murphy and Kelly play hide the flute. They're taking it in the can. A credit to old Imus, his McNamara's back.
That will be fine.
Deeply speckled face. The win for number.
No.
6720.
How did this get out of control?
There you go. Right, pass the beers. Take that for a beer. Pass this one over to Laurie McNipples, will you? Sorry, your feet. I don't have any marijuana for you this morning.
That's all right.
You can always smoke this, you sleazy little punk, you be Jesus.
That will be fine.
Why don't you get a lip lock on an exhaust pipe, you Jesus? Start sucking that, you sad face cloud, you. A few more of these things and we'll be doing the Irish jig on the A man's chest.
That will be fine.
Shut up, you sound like a fool.
Do we have a what doesn't belong and why yet?
If I ever start to sound a bit like Amos, it's time for euthanasia, sure as day. For he whines, complains, and babbles like me grandma, with never much of anything to say. The picture numbers is as follows.
We don't care about them at this point.
Let me ask you this, I, Mr. Marn.
Yeah.
How can you always pick out the Irishman in a hospital ward?
Uh-oh. You know, we just don't want to know this.
He's the one blowing the suds off of the bedpan, Jesus. Pick their numbers. 3, 6, 7, 11, 17, 18, 20, 23, 29, 31, 36, 59, 62, 64, 68, 72, 76, 77, 80.
What?
Which doesn't belong and why?
All right, which doesn't belong and why?
Which doesn't belong and why?
Oh, God.
A, Nelson Mandela.
Nelson Mandela.
Oh. B, Idi Amin.
Oh.
C, Tarzan. Which doesn't belong and why?
Oh, God. Well, Tarzan.
Wrong, you two-legged anal rot, you be Jesus.
Oh, come on.
Well, all three are African leaders and are currently in secret negotiations to succeed Pat Riley as coach of the hooligan Nairobi Knicks.
Oh, goody.
No, not Jane Goodall, you little dirtbag, you shut up. The answer is A. Nelson Mandela doesn't belong because, unlike the other two, Mandela has an unfair advantage due to his lengthy prison record, be Jesus.
Well, not a great end there.
La, 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 la.
John Connell O'Connor here on the Irish Morning. So much for sophisticated political comedy here on this hideous program. Andy Rooney this week is thinking about the trials and travails of media magnates. Andy?
It's lonely at the top. At least that...
You know, it depends. It's negotiable.
Well, what does negotiable mean?
How could it be? You know, I mean...
What's your wife look like?
She's good looking.
Shut up, Bernard. I thought I told you to butt out, Bernard.
Hey, as a matter of fact, Steven Spielberg's filming a movie out here. Amistad, his first DreamWorks production. You're always getting on him. He's finally going to do something.
Right.
And my wife got cast as an extra in there.
Well, she did.
Yeah. She's going to be a New Haven woman, an aristocrat, I guess.
Okay.
But anyway, besides that,
how'd you get the part?
Well, actually, I sent in my two kids are models. Well, you know, a little bit.
Yeah.
I do all right. I do a little theater on the side.
Oh, you do?
And what happened was I sent in all our pictures. My kids have their professional portfolio pictures I sent, plus mine, which is a regular headshot.
Right.
I sent my wife's picture at the half. It's a small picture cut in half.
Mm-hmm.
It's about the size of a pocket shot.
Mm-hmm.
I send it to them. They pick her.
Well?
Not me. Not my two beautiful kids. Not that she's not beautiful.
Yeah, you're not going to be in a movie.
Yeah, well, maybe. They might call me. They're
not going to call me. No. And you
don't. Come on, man. You guys are killing me.
No, you're not going to be in a movie. The kids are not going to be in a movie.
Yeah, they are.
Your wife's going to be in a movie. She's going to run off with Steven Spielberg.
Hey, that few things could be worse.
So you're losing your dog and your wife.
And Elvis has left the building.
And Elvis has left the building.
Elvis is roadkill.
Anyway, if anybody has any info, please call the Cranston Police Department. I have my name in there.
Oh, okay. I hope you get your dog, baby.
But I appreciate all your help, man, and keep up the good work. And by the way, you laid down with Christopher Dodd last week, man. That was pitiful.
What?
Oh, you laid down, man.
What are you talking about?
Come on, man. A week ago, okay, you were on him saying, where's Christopher Dodd? He hasn't shown his face, you know, in a month since all this Democratic crap hit the fan. And then all of a sudden you get on there and you lay down.
No. That's not what I did.
Yes, you did. You didn't ask him one tough question. You're sitting there.
Oh, yeah, God. What are you, nuts?
Come on, you're kissing his ass.
It was.
No.
Get out of here.
That's absolutely. It was hammer time for Senator Dodd.
Yeah, come on. You let him off easy.
And I let him off at nothing.
You did, man.
I hope your dog's dead. Well, Bernie, you're no one to talk. You don't come up smelling like a rose in that whole deal.
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Uh-huh.
You're the guy dissing his pit bull, hoping his dog is roadkill.
I'm not the focus. You wished his dog was dead.
No, but I was kidding there at the end. I was sympathetic through that entire call.
Well, it was a pit bull, for crying out loud.
Oh, okay, well, see, that's my point. So you have no right to get on me, does he?
I he did not come off.
No, you. No, I guess you'd forgotten with your little input and all that, didn't you?
He didn't come off well.
You're calling me a dog murderer.
Well, you are. You wished his dog was dead, and what happened?
So did you.
His dog is dead.
Yes, but I only wished it after he attacked me. Nobody hammered Chris Dodd harder than I did. So the guy's jerking my chain about that. And I just, sort of a comedic exclamation point to the conversation, said, I hope your dog's dead. But in the course of the conversation, you were, one, dissing the fact that the dog was a pit bull, and, two, hoping that it was roadkill.
Sounded compassionate.
And I, exactly, thank you, Charles, I sounded compassionate throughout this entire conversation was commiserating
Bernard,
with the guy. You were attacking him and ridiculing him throughout the entire conversation, making fun of him and the fact that he had a pit bull, implying that the dog was dangerous.
You can't be losing a damn pit bull.
That's
out
my
in the
point.
Streets.
But don't call me a dog murderer.
Well, I can only state the facts.
Well, there are no facts. We just heard what the facts were.
I need to be refreshed.
You need to take a break, what you need to do.
It's time for the news, and here with that is Charles McCoy. Good morning, Chuck.
Morning, I-Man. President.
Well, what are you looking at me for?
Well, you know exactly why.
No, I don't. Why?
Well, this whole unfortunate caninicide incident that lays now at your feet.
No. I didn't kill this guy's dog, and Bernard was the one who was...
Bernard did not come off well, but who had the final word?
Mm-hmm. Whose name is on the marquee?
Well, I understand all of that.
Well.
But, I mean, the tape speaks for itself. I was sympathetic throughout that entire conversation with that guy.
You feigned a degree of compassion.
But I didn't feign anything. I was compassionate.
But at the end of the conversation...
Well, when the guy was jerking my chain about Chris Dodd.
Right. You threw the dog in front of a truck, basically.
No, but you're the one who described the hope the dog was roadkill.
What is it, Bernard?
Unfortunately, it is roadkill.
Yeah, so
thanks to you.
Thanks to me.
You wished his dog dead.
Yes, but I mean, so did you. And you did so in a vicious, malicious manner. I did so in a comedic manner, or at least...
Right.
I hope your dog's dead.
Oh, my sides.
Oh, man.
A regular yucklebuck,
I'm
Well,
I'm not taking a rap here as a dog murderer, I'll tell you that now.
Somebody's going down, Shane. It's not going to be me. Jay Cagney.
Well, it's not going to be me, Jay. Bernard came off sounded bad.
Why, he did. Really killed a guy because he had a pit bull.
Because he lost the stupid pit bull.
Well, yeah, irresponsible. Well, who lets their dog
just go wander out and do its duty? And it's gone for 2 hours.
And then he'll come back on his own.
But he usually comes back after 2 hours. What's he out doing during the 2 hours? Killing chickens?
It's like a promiscuous homosexual, for crying out loud.
Come on.
Just as dangerous.
You can't be doing that.
Watch your dog.
Well, okay, but I mean,
So everybody shares a degree of culpability here. The I-Man, the owner of the dog, and Mr. McGurk.
I don't share any culpability in this because I was compassionate and sympathetic through the entire conversation with the guy and only out of frustration because he was nailing me about the Chris Dodd thing, which was preposterous, I just said, I hope your dog's dead. But clearly I didn't mean that when, in fact, you could tell Bernard did mean it. Bernard was outraged that the guy had a pit bull to start with.
It was allowing it to roam.
And equally outraged that they let the dog get loose.
Do they have a leash law up there for crying out loud?
Well, apparently not.
Well, the whole thing.
And unfortunately, the guy's dog the dog's dead. That's all. Yeah. Like your dog, Bud's dead.
Chinese
well,
restaurant.
I know that.
Two dead dogs now.
Belt now.
Moo goo guy puppy.
You ain't nothing but a hound. Been snooping around my door. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Been snooping around my door. You can wag your tail, but I ain't gonna feed you no more.
I'm a in the morning. It's cool for you.
I never seen nobody.
Jonah's as hot as the...
I don't care if you don't want me. I'm yours right now. I'll put a spell on you.
Doggy dog.
Oh, wait.
Lift your hind leg up in the air and shake it like you just don't care. Snoop in the house busting dope rhymes. Got the 411 like the New Jack Times. That punk-ass bitch, Tim McVeigh. Debts to society, he'll never repay. Cause though the jury called the defense his bluff, I don't think the death penalty is quite severe enough. A lethal injection ain't valid. He should be stuck in the joint, tossing a brother salad. They say justice is blind, so will the guards when Tim Selmets get behind. The new justice to the bump and grind. Every day of his life, 168 times. His lawyers farmed out with their legal fertilizer. But a life being butt boy is a great equalizer. Yo, Timmy, you know in prison how convicts get out their anger? By getting in your behind. 20 minutes of that boy, you been screaming for somebody to kill you. In the House, an amendment passed, but the Senate probably sit on his ass and do their best to sandbag. A law preventing people from burning the flag. The KKK is at a loss, cause nobody never stop them when they go to burn a cross. Civil liberties gotta be protected, but the flag is a symbol that must be respected. I ain't looking for applause, but a man should be loyal to his cause. The Constitution should have another clause. An amendment against burning, bet it should bars. Yo, she a symbol, man. To all us black people and whatnot. Don't be desecrating the girl. Well, I'ma have to smoke your ass.
Imus in the morning.
This is the Imus in the Morning program. WFAN New York. Right now it is 73.
Just another pathetic, lame attempt of like a Mark and Brian deal.
That's pitiful.
Plug it in. Let me see. Here we go.
We had the Business News Network. We wanted to put that back on.
Uh-huh.
And then they wouldn't do it, so Imus was available. Yeah. So actually, it was number 8 choice.
Yeah, and it worked out.
Okay, so we got this schmuck. He's our number 8 choice. And we throw him on in the morning. And the first thing he does, he goes after my woman. Yeah. Goes after my woman.
Very uncomfortable.
Goes after your woman? Yeah. This washed-up old guy. Broadcasting his garbage out of New York, which I hope does very well, by the way, on The Zone.
Yeah.
So listen daily from 6 to 10.
6 to 10 on...
that's how weak this is.
So he after you.
You're either going to diss the I-Man or not.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not have this ambivalence for crying out loud. What the... Idiots.
It's painful, isn't it?
Well, it's embarrassing.
So, and another reason... You know, there's a price to pay to be syndicated around the country. Now, unlike every other syndicated program on the planet, with the exception of Howard Stern, you have to pay for this program. All of the other shows, they give away. So when you hear about some show being on 300 stations, they give it away.
Well, of course they're on.
And it's on, of course they're on. It's on at night or some, you know. When you're on 100 stations in the morning, then you are a force to be reckoned with in this country.
Absolutely.
And every one of them has to pay through the nose for it. But it's like being associated with MSNBC, which I'm more upset about than I care to even get into on the radio. Because of being dissed by these bastards in a disgraceful manner.
Not even any subtlety involved.
Yeah, I mean, don't put me in a row of pictures with people like
Soledad
O'Brien and Stone Phillips. And I mean... But you know, you lose that ability to control that aspect of the situation by agreeing to participate in their effort, you know.
Well, yeah.
In this particular case, allowing them to televise the Imus in the Morning radio program on MSNBC.
Which is becoming
a festering sore of irritation.
And a regrettable move.
So
And I don't know if you can correct it now. I mean, is,
no.
it, is there something?
Well, no, the yeah. damage has been done.
That's what I'm... Well, no, I meant if there's any legal relief or anything that you might see.
Well, I'm not going to waste my money suing them. I couldn't sue them anyway.
Get both needles.
If I could. I mean, we could have somebody beat up, which is the way I settle most things anyway. Mm-hmm. To threaten people.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I used to find it amusing with this woman who broke into David Letterman's house. Somebody would break into my house once, and that'd be the end of it. They'd never do it again. Somebody threatened me once, and that's the end of it.
Sure.
They don't threaten me anymore.
No. Seeing that happen.
Here's Jaleel now from Boston. Good morning, Jaleel.
Good morning, genius.
How you doing, baby?
How are you? By the way, I-Man, you did a job on Dick Cabot.
I like Dick Cabot.
I know. You invited him on your show a few times. He thought he could do a show on his own. Guess where he is today?
Where?
He's attending group therapy.
Well.
That happened.
Where are you from, baby?
Well, I was born in Iran, so I've been here ever since. By the way, I brought some rocks from Hebron.
How you feel about my boy, Salman Rusky?
Oh, he...
Or Rusty.
You know what John Lennon called him from CBS?
No.
He called him a bastard of history.
Hmm.
He says because apparently his mama fooled around a little bit with the British when they were taking over the India. As a result, became Salman Rushdie. And you know, the bastards usually never do anything right.
I know.
That's history. I asked Charles. He could tell you.
Tell you, let me ask you something, baby.
Sure.
Tell you, I'm man of truth now.
Okay.
Where you at on this Israeli-Palestinian deal? Talk to me, baby.
All right. I think I spoke with Benjamin Netanyahu. He said as long as they're going to be towel heads, they're not going to go anywhere.
Well, all right.
By the way, I'm in. I think... Mr. Netanyahu on his way to New York to attend to Bible study for Charles's, and they're going to get to the bottom of this. By the way, what should I do with this, some of this stone? Because Bernie says he wants some of this stone to show on MSNBC. Should I send it to him? He said he needs it when the show's on simulcast.
Put him in the back of your cab and tell him.
Jaleel Leno on the phone.
Yeah. What are you doing in Boston, Jaleel?
Huh?
What do you do in Boston?
I have a little business that I cannot tell you about. Because Bernie told me once you tell Iman, he's going to steal the idea.
Well, okay.
By the way, Iman, Bernie is a funny guy. He is a funny. Do you think we can get him on Boston's little stand-up?
I think if the price is right, we can arrange something, yes. Absolutely.
Iman, by the way, you know you mentioned these little stooge in, what's that, Atlantis? Was it in, I can't even remember the station they were making fun of you.
All those three fat bastards in Atlanta, yeah.
Exactly,
yeah.
Because unless they mention you, their show will not amount to anything. Because Howard Stern keeps saying that. He said, if I don't talk about Iman, what else could I get attention?
Yeah.
And he said, by the way, he's going to get over it with the situation with you if you go see his movie.
I understand that.
And now he sees me, he says he wants to cancel tickets.
Jaleel.
Is my Slurpee ready yet?
Jaleel.
Yes.
Give me a pack of Winston's.
Okay.
And a couple of beef jerkies. I gotta go.
Two quick picks.
All right, here now on the Imus in the Morning program, my fat friend, Rush Limbaugh. Good morning, Rush.
My friends, it is I, your hidebound Hercules, speaking to you from high above this mortal coil as I stand upon the Mount Olympus of broadcasting the EIB, efforting the indictment of Bubba. You know, speaking of Greek mythology, did you know that the god responsible for commerce is also that of cunning and theft?
No.
Sound like anyone we know?
Well,
here's a Grecian formula. Hermes has herpes. There is a canker sore in the presidency, and it's time we burn that sucker out. I am quite frankly at a loss as to why Bill Clinton is allowed to maintain his stranglehold on this country. 25 years ago, a couple of Puerto Ricans at a hotel were enough to take down the Nixon White House and presidency. Why aren't a couple of Orientals at a presidency that treats the White House as a hotel enough to take down Bubba? Especially when there is no doubt in anyone's mind as to who appears to be the bigger dick. Perhaps it's because Bill Clinton consistently paints himself as a hero. And yet, if you examine his record, his behavior would suggest that, dramatically speaking, he is the antagonist of the United States. He's been indefensible before, but now he literally doesn't have a leg to stand on. His recent and I might add, quite prophetically symbolic, fall has further illustrated his uncanny similitude with Richard
the Third, the handicapped, morally bankrupt king of Shakespearean tragedy. There he is, wheeling around the battlefield, screaming, "A whore! A whore! My kingdom for a whore!" Oh, look! My brilliant Elizabethan parody has invoked the appearance of my bemused muse. Time for a sonnet from your lard but bard. Here now, another ode to William the Third.
Oh, great.
Despite the fact that you're a scurvy worm, so far you have eluded Kenneth Starr. And though you're lamer than your second term, that wheelchair doesn't make you FDR. No. Your administration is unruly, indicted in denial or in shame, taking bribes from Indians, crooks, and coolies, happy to take the buck and pass the blame. Though you find it all so aggravating, fear the decision of the Supreme Court. Think Paula Jones was emasculating? Your second term's about to be cut short. Finally comes the time when you inhale. With pants around your ankles, they're in jail.
Here now, the President of the United States, Bill Clinton.
I beg your pardon.
Yeah.
I never promised you a full pardon. I know you're confined. But y'all are gonna have to do some time. Didn't mean to throw a curve, but you may have to serve just a few.
General George S. Patton.
At ease, as you were. You people are here to participate today in Geopolitics 1997, Tango Iceman, Tango Tango Yellow, Bravo Alpha Bravo Yellow. Who can decipher? You, soldier.
Sir, we're taking part in, Tango Iceman, Tango Tango Yellow, Bravo Alpha Bravo Yellow. That'll be Geopolitics 1997, Titty Baby, sir.
You are a winner on Jeopardy, soldier. Good work. That is exactly what we're here to discuss. The 11th summit between pathetic Moscow sot Boris Yeltsin and pathetic American titty baby William Jefferson Clinton. Let's go to the overhead projector. Somebody give me a Middle East peace process on that light array up there.
Sir, I got it, sir.
Ceasefire! Ceasefire! How many times do I have to tell you that shooting the wounded is a violation of the Geneva Accord?
Sir, sorry, sir.
Step up here, Private, so I can knock the sh** out of you.
Sir, yes, sir.
What's your name anyway, soldier?
Riddick Bowes, sir. I'm gonna go home if this is the way you're gonna treat me.
Get out. All right, for the rest of you fine fighting units, let's get back to our subject. First slide, geographical area. Anybody tell me what we're looking at here?
Sir, Europe, Eastern Bloc, Czech Republic, Hungary, and the country where all the women have that chipped front tooth, sir.
Yes, Poland. Very good. These three countries were once behind the Iron Curtain back in the good old days of the Warsaw Pact. Now they are behind the lace doily, it appears. And we want them in our very fine North Atlantic Treaty Organization. I say, unlike our namby-pamby fish-faced commander-in-chief, that we simply take them. But we've got a one-legged loser whose position is that we should negotiate. Negotiate what? Whether or not we're going to bomb them with 50-megaton warheads or 100-megaton warheads if they don't cooperate? The Red Army people is down to 25 guys with a musket arguing over whether they're going to shoot it or eat it. Oh, and speaking of eating, if I may make an aside, yeah. How appropriate was it that they had to get Bubba on and off Air Force One on a catering truck? Oh, no, he won't blow up after this knee surgery. Hell, in 3 months, there'll be an independent prosecutor trying to decide whether to keep him in the Oval Office or put him in a fish tank. Hey, at ease. Anyway, our strategy regarding NATO expansion should be as follows. Say to Yeltsin, hey, vodka gut, your fly's unzipped. Then when he looks to see, we have General Shalikashvili get down on his hands and knees behind the f***ing rummy and push him over. Face it, people, what are they going to do about it in the Kremlin? To prevent us from expanding NATO into Lenin's tomb if we by God want to. Because the only thing that's in the toilet worse than Russia is Howard Stern's movie career. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
Oh, it's crying time again. You're gonna leave me. I can see that faraway look in your eyes. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time.
Kind of see the morning.
Toyota's main hotline phone line service. We're having to expand, eh, Imus?
So many of you have called. It's been so gratifying.
That's right. The Imus hotline phone line is going interactive. Now, Mr. Imus Zealot, not only is the Donald standing by to talk just to you regarding intimate secrets of his life, you can specify the exact Imus life area you want to know more about.
Imus! 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 Imus!
Imus. Okay, Imusites, here's the new hotline deal. For just a small additional monthly charge, your touch-tone phone will allow you to plug in only to the Imus category you and you alone need to talk to him about. Press 1 for the latest running information.
Hi, it's Imus. I counted my running shoes again last night. Call me for the new total. It's quite a figure.
That ought to squelch those rumors about how he has no life, eh? And the rest of the Imus interactive menu? I hope you're sitting down. Press 2 for late nutrition information. Press 3 for really cute cat care anecdotes. Press 5 for Imus health bulletins, updated hourly, including neck news, dentistry whining, and gum disease follow-up care. Press 7 to hear Imus drone on about another book. Enter an 8, hear another groundless Imus tirade against a defenseless little person. 9 to hear Imus shamelessly name drop and kiss up to an absolutely valueless but rich phony. 10 brings you your own detailed personal Imus preview of the next 3 testicles episode. And finally, and appropriately, enter the number 12 for the interminable addiction rap. At any point in the Imus interactive menu, press 13 for automatic connection to a suicide counselor, your local poison control bureau, or the Connecticut Coma Rehabilitation Center in Norwalk. Imus goes interactive.
1-900-BOREDOM-CALLERS. There's a one-time monthly charge for Imus interactive service of $1,000, over and above normal per-call charges. Kids, get mom and dad's permission, or start the car in the garage tonight and gas them. The Imus interactive intimate hotline is a service of stick foreign objects down my throat and gag myself to death, Inc. Call now because he has nothing else to do.
Hey, Bubba, what's the deal with those huge books? Are they your bimbo phone numbers?
Nah, they're not that big. This here's my 5-volume set of budget documents, Divas. My $1.69 trillion plan to cut taxes for the middle class, upgrade education, and finally have everything balance out in 2002.
How come it's gonna take that long?
Because that way, if it doesn't happen, I'll already be out of office a whole 2 years.
You may be out of office for longer than 2 years by the time 2002 rolls around. Where are you gonna get all that money? By sticking it to all those old dudes on Medicare?
Yep. Why should we pay for their rheumatism? Get a job, Grandpa.
Aren't you worried that you might, like, piss him off?
What are they going to do? Not vote for me again?
Even if you could run for another term, they'd either be in a chair with clean corn falling out of their mouth or dead.
This is a good budget plan, Beavis. A $1.1 billion increase for law enforcement programs, $7.6 billion more for the Environmental Protection Agency, $100 million to speed up the Internet.
Yeah, it takes too long to download those naked pictures of Terry Hatcher.
And there's another $8.5 million in there for O.J.
You've allocated money in the federal budget for O.J. Simpson?
I learned something the other night when he almost stole all my thunder. So long as I can keep him afloat, he can be a pretty good diversion. Besides, I may need him to go pay Paul Jones a little visit.
True story from the Believe It or Not file. Day is a woman who not only believes...
So I don't know if I would just poo-poo it and put it off to the side. It's a New York story and the New York papers are trying to make more of it. I think not. We're coming back with a bonus hour before Mike and the Mad Dog at 2.
Morons who does one of these talk shows on this radio station, WFAN in New York, pretending to be, you know, one of the callers like Antoine from the Bronx.
Antoine in the Bronx. Antoine, how are you?
Hey, yo, Joe Benigno, man. What's up, man?
What's up, baby?
Long time listener, man. Yo, turn the radio down on the air, man.
What's up, yo?
Do you know why I'm upset, man?
Why are you upset?
Yo, in a melting pot here, we call New York, we can't get a black coach, there's no black quarterbacks, no black pitchers, no black nothing, man. What's up with that? You gotta get a brother in there for the big brothers, you know what I'm saying?
In the morning.
I hear you speaking on a lot of hockey issues, too. You know what I'm saying? I don't like hockey. You know what I'm saying?
Well, that's your problem.
You know, because if it's hockey, like it. The only thing black is the puck, and they be smacking that around.
Cheated out of a win. Good morning. Mike Braidwood Sports. A heck of a handsome play-by-play guy with the call. Knicks cannot overcome Dirty Hornet tactics, on-the-take referees, and the enormous pressure of just being America's team as they disappointed millions across this world with a 93-86 loss to the Hornets. Patrick Ewing, their fine center, knew what happened.
We just didn't execute. We didn't execute.
Jeff Van Gundy, when asked about his team's execution, said, "I'm all for it." But the Knicks need time to gel. It takes time to put a team together, much like it takes time to put a tune together.
Oh, no. No.
It's more than just saying, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. And that reminds me of a song. Do, a deer, a female deer, re, a drop of golden sun. I man the name he calls himself. Some days I wish I had a gun. Phone boots or where he goes to pee. His wife got rich at 23. He sucks on MSNBC. And we all hope that his lung collapses. Oh, a deer, the I man's near. I'd like to fill his chest with lead. He used to talk of women's breast, but now it's boring guest and friend. He has a tendency to drool. He thinks his cowboy hat looks cool. His wife's in elementary school, and she's hoping he's soon 6 feet under. Do-re-mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do.
Right now from Amherst, Massachusetts, here, little Michael. Good morning, Michael.
What's up, man?
Well,
I love your show.
You do?
Yes.
How old are you?
I'm 12.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, man.
You notice, whenever we go to these, whenever we appear places,
yeah,
all the kids like Michael who show up are about his age.
Yeah.
They're all strange kids, aren't they?
They're a little twisted, yeah, I can see that.
They're not your normal little gangster hoodlum gang members,
no,
are they?
No, they're quite different, in fact, you're right.
So, what is it you like about the show, Michael?
Hey, it's funny, man. I like the political justice stuff.
You do?
Bernard, man.
Forget Bernard.
What are you doing this weekend?
That will be fun. So, what's your dad do?
My dad has a radio show himself.
Oh, he does?
Yeah.
What time is he on?
Oh, he's on in Worcester, Mass, and in Boston, and he's going to be on in San Francisco.
Oh, he is?
Yeah.
What's his name?
His name is Glenn Brooks.
What is it?
Glenn Brooks.
You ever heard of him, John?
Yeah, no, I haven't.
You have, Bernard?
I have. He's the first gay DJ on the East Coast.
You what?
First gay DJ on the East Coast.
He's not a gay. You know, you're...
Shut the f*** up, Bernard.
I thought you said they were different when they came
in. Yeah, they're not hoodlums.
No, they're not at all.
Not the eye kids.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Another friend of Bernard's
class. Okay. Well, I don't... Man. Here's the thing. I mean, I don't blame the kids.
I love you. You love me. We're as happy as can be.
Little jerk. You're the one who jacked the kid's father. What'd you expect him to do?
Show some respect.
Well, yeah. Charlie's the first gay disc jockey on the East Coast, I think, yes.
Well, there you go.
KLAC Los Angeles. Well, here's the benefit that the stations around the country have, is they can edit that out when they get it.
Thank heaven.
Yeah, that's nice. Have fun.
What the heck was that?
They can knock a few pimples off his mug.
Yeah, no kidding.
And the eye man sat here and missed a switch. So.
Jerk a knot in his tail.
That'll be today's promo, right?
Sounds like you off the air. I don't know what's going on here.
Yeah, I know who it was talking to.
The young man without testosterone.
Well, her name was Sheila. We used to go to Sunday school, and every day, Sheila would say, "Do you want to come out and play?" And I'd say, "I'd love to, Sheila, but I can't, because your dad works for my dad."
Now, good morning, Mr. McNeil.
Good morning.
So what are these, Mr. McNeil, what are these dirty books about?
I learned it all from listening to you, you know. I've been listening to you from the days when you used to, this time of the morning, you'd phone up strange women, get them on the phone in their bedrooms and ask them what they were wearing. Do you remember that?
Yeah, vaguely.
You don't do that anymore?
Well, not on the air, no. Your radio sounds funny, Marty. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Incidentally, Lara the other night at a party, he was talking about my going, and he said, now I know how Abbott felt when Costello left. I know how... Brinkley thought when Huntley left, and then he paused and he said, "And I know how Dan felt when Connie left."
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Someday.
The following is a paid political announcement. Here, speaking on behalf of the Excuse Another Kennedy Preservation Society, the senior senator from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the Honorable Edward M. Kennedy.
I'll have to call you back. I don't care what you're wearing. I'm about to go on the air here.
Senator.
Really? The frilly one with the Velcro? And
Senator, we're on the air.
Yes. Just discussing a matter of women's wear manufacture with a constituent, yes. Now, as doubtless you are aware at this juncture, the curse of Camelot continues to hover menacingly over members of my family. Not a day goes by, it seems, that something isn't written or broadcast concerning a Kennedy either getting divorced, getting married, getting something annulled, or getting laid. You, the voting public, wonder why. The answer is simple. We are rich, cavalier in our attitudes toward the little people. You make a great pretense of caring for our fellow man, especially the downtrodden and disadvantaged, but in fact could not possibly care less. with the exceptions of the Shrivers, Tim and his mother Eunice, who do seem to be genuine in their work with those of our society who are missing the toy surprise from their Happy Meal. Beyond that, the Kennedy family, to be candid, has no redeeming social value and would be just another clan of alcoholic mix being unceremoniously thrown out of bars if we didn't own the bars, either in fact or in effect, through our enormous political clout, obtained immorally through the ill-gotten gains of our father, Joe. Now, I rise in defense of two members of the younger Kennedy generation who are carrying forward the traditions of previous generations. Joseph Kennedy II, the congressman, and Michael Kennedy I, the creep. Joseph, a true blockhead, cannot remember with precision what he knew of Michael's affair with a 14-year-old babysitter, or when he knew it. Joseph himself is the subject of negative publicity for trading in one wife for another and seeking to have marriage one erased in favor of validating marriage two. As for my own history with the other gender, well, the record speaks for itself. Exactly. I have tried to examine carefully our common Kennedy problem that has plagued so many in our family across the years. My late brother John, my late brother Bobby, myself, Joe, Michael, Willie, and all the rest. I have been led to one conclusion as the basis of our difficulties. Erectile tissue, coupled to a complete inability to keep our barn doors closed. And so, let the word go forth from this time and place that the torch has been passed to a new generation. My nephews, Michael and Joe, who are courageously carrying forward the Kennedy philosophy that time heals all wounds, though not as fast as money. And our oldest, most cherished family maxim, that a Kennedy, even though caught in the sack with a babysitter, erected, could run for office in Massachusetts and still get elected. Thank you.
The preceding paid for by the Excuse and Other Kennedy Preservation Society and the Democratic National Committee, both wholly owned subsidiaries of the People's Republic of China.
We're out in the middle of the Navajo Indian Reservation. They're on the border of Arizona and Utah. Why, do you ever figure out how many miles you drove yesterday, friend?
No, I had it on the kilometers for a while.
I don't think Dan Redden thought it was amusing when you kept calling him, referring to him as Mike and Mr. Wallace, do you?
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
Now, this fat Navajo guy, Duel, name is Key, K-E-E. And Fred introduces Dan Rather to him, you know. Rather's hearing's like ours, you know. But his is from artillery shells or something. Anyway, Rather says, nice to meet you, Chief.